Has it become the norm for our life? like Bible, two-edged sword. It will disturb us. It will challenge us. It will call us to transform our life. It's a treasure we have with us. And the treasure was not given into our hands for so many years. Because Protestants, when they took the Bible, actually I heard from somebody, when Martin Luther, the Augustinian monk, professor of scripture in Germany, when he was disturbed by Vatican style of living, this is not the Jesus of Nazareth. This is not the life of the poor man of Galilee. So therefore, he went down all the way from Germany to Vatican. With all respect, he fell on the ground and kissed the ground because I'm entering into holy ground. And he asked for an appointment with the Holy Father in the 16th century that I would like to once again explain, we are not living the Bible. We are preaching a different Jesus. But he was refused appointment. When he was refused appointment, he said, you don't want to meet me and listen to me, then I will leave this Catholic Church. That day he went back to Germany and took with him so nearly 4,000 to 5,000 Germans split began in the Catholic Church. And then they took the Bible as their only norm. We will read and reflect and allow the Bible to transform our life. This is the living and loving Word of God. So when they took the Bible, Catholics, Vatican said, we will not take the Bible. So we will take statues, novenas, sacraments, because they are taking Bible. So we will not take. So many years, we were not allowed to read Bible. But Vatican Council came as a blessing. Said, Bible is ours. It's Jesus' word. Therefore read. But 50 years over, we are celebrating Jubilee now. But has it become our companion? Have we understood? Every word there challenges our life. So therefore, Holy Father is reminding once again, Gospel. We will, read about this little later. Gospel should be the norm in our formation houses. Because we have not introduced the Bible from the beginning, till today now, we are not familiar with the Bible. Second, constant return to the sources of your founder. Let the fire burning in the hearts and minds of your founder or foundress, let it continue to burn in your hearts and minds today. It's time now to pray to the Holy Spirit. Oh Holy Spirit, set our hearts on fire. Come Holy Spirit, inflame our hearts. Let the fire be burning today as they were disturbed. They heard the cry of the people those days and responded. May we have the same spirit. So constantly return. What made them to found our congregations? Let the spirit be burning. That's the second. Third, adapt religious life to the signs of the times. What are the signs of the times? General signs of the times. You have to find out in Thailand what are the visible signs of the times. General times, signs of the times. Number one, hunger for spirituality. In general, we find among people there is a kind of hunger. This hunger for spirituality is sincere and genuine. This is one of the signs of the times. You can see people flocking. It's not just a prayer. They are looking for a God experience. And even in India, we have a quota, not the center, 10,000, 15,000 people stretching their arms and shedding tears and praying. When you look at this scene, you feel people are somewhere searching for God experience. It's the God experience, religious experience. They are not looking for intellectual ideas. It's not that they are not asking for dogmas or doctrines. They are looking for God experience. One of the reasons for Catholics leaving the Catholic Church and joining Pentecostal and other movements, because we don't experience God in the Catholic Church. So after attending all the sacraments and liturgical celebrations, we have the feeling that we have seen the Mass, but we have not experienced it. It's a challenge for us. We are not blaming anybody. Again and again, we need to look into our life. So hunger for spirituality, this hunger cannot be nourished by our traditional churches. Something else we need. The second signs of the times, hunger for mysticism. Whether you believe it or not, people started reading the mystics. They have started reading the life history of Thomas Merton, John of the Cross, St. Avila Teresa, St. Catherine of Siena. Why they are going back again to read this? Mystics are not extraordinary people who perform miracles. You shouldn't think. Mystics are not extraordinary people. They are ordinary people who have taken God very seriously. That's the meaning. Taking God seriously. And they are not satisfied with just believing God who is existing. Not just that God is existing or the divine person. They claim that they experience God in day-to-day life, in their life and in the society. Experiencing God. So this hunger for mystical experience, you take Taizé, no? France, a retreat center in France. Thousands and thousands of young people are going who don't come to our churches. Why they are going there? The freedom that it provides them. In Taizé, there are no long sermons, no long liturgical celebrations. Silently they all sit. They reflect the Bible. Bible is their guide. They discuss about the Bible. Long silence. Even the prayer or the songs, repetitive songs, you know that. Same one line, they keep on repeating, and some experience. Not too many shoutings and too many words and too many prayers. This is the kind of prayer young people are looking for today. Maybe our Pentecostal movement, charismatic movement, New Age movement, Jesus Youth movement, these are all movements. They are flexible. They are responding to the aspirations of the people, especially the youth today. Movements. What they are not getting. In our churches, they feel they are getting only the authoritarian teachings. Legalism. Dogmas and doctrines, which is not touching them. This is one of the times. Don't ask me why. This is what we see today among the youth. And these people are going Pentecostal movement today. How they are drawing people? Charismatic. Charismatic, the outpouring of the Spirit. That's an experience they get there. And then this is what the next signs of the time. The third signs of the times, from my own experience, there are plenty. You can also, you know it, and you can also share with others. Third, the thirst for the Word of God. Today, plenty of people are going for Bible study, night vigils, fasting prayer, and they want to listen to the interpretation of the Bible. And people are quoting Bible. And not only they are quoting, and they are connecting it with the reality of their life. And this is one of the signs of the times. We religious need to train our people. If we don't train to interpret and preach the Word of God, many more people will be leaving Catholic Church. They are going, what they are looking for, if it is not them. They are not children to be stolen. They are adults. They make a decision. After joining Pentecostal, that's why many people, if you talk to them, they say, we stop drinking. We stop watching television. We started reading the Word of God in our families. Our family pray together. During weekends, we go to the hospitals and families and we pray with the Word of God. So, this is attracting people. So, how we trained our religious to understand the Word of God, to interpret the Word of God, to quote the Word of God, and to so many lay people are today, they quote and then they interpret the Word of God. So this is one of the signs. This also affects our ministries, calling us to re-look into our ministries. So another signs of the times, maybe in India again, rise of liberation movements. So many liberation movements, the voice of the voiceless is heard today very loudly through these liberation movements. Earlier they were suppressed, quiet. Today rising. Women movements all over the world. WSF, World Social Forum, a new world is possible. All over the world, maybe country different, language different, color different, but women all over the world, women. So they come together. Women movements everywhere. And the tribal and indigenous movements. Women are coming together asking for equality. Indigenous people, tribal people, Dalit people, they join the movements asking for dignity and freedom. Labor and farmer movements, they are asking for their rights. Ecological movements, fighting against the global warming, fighting against the cutting of the trees and deforestation. Human rights movements, wherever human rights are violated, these people, they make noise and they bring to the public, rights are violated here and they become very angry. So we need to join hands with these movements. This will also affect our ministries. Another important awareness is awareness of gender equality. Gender equality. Everywhere, now people started talking about. Even Holy Father, January when he went to Philippines, when he was addressing at the University of St. Thomas, UST, he noticed five people on the stage to address. Among the five, he said, four were males. Only one female. He noticed it. And he said even very beautifully, at times we men don't allow room for women. I don't know, maybe women also sometimes may not come forward. But women are capable of seeing things with a different angle from us. Women are able to pose questions that we men are not able to understand. He ended his remarks always with a joke. So when next Pope comes to Manila, he said, I hope there will be more women among you. He already hinted, next Pope only will come to Manila. And he said, this is a very little representation on the stage. Again and again he said, it's too little, he said. Too little representation. So awareness of gender equality. How are we empowering our women? How we refuse to be silent and to be silenced. How we know our rights. Our rights. How many times our rights, we allow them to be suppressed. It's not arrogance. It's not arrogance, it's insecurity. Asserting our rights. They are God-given rights. God has given the rights for each one. So therefore, these are all the signs of. So let's not dwell on small issues of our community. There will be always problems in our community. If you start dealing with the issues, there are a lot of issues outside calling for our consecrated life in the 21st century. So many problems in the community. Sometimes as Jesus said, that only I remember, forgive them. They do not know what they are doing. That's why you have to say. If they know, they won't do that. Not because I'm very good. No. God's grace. If I could help them, I'll try. You know, there are three types of people. Everywhere, in every group. One group, they move, no? They automatically move. They don't need big seminars and retreats to move. They can easily move. They grow. Second group, they are movable. You have to move them. Like the seminars and retreats and renewal sessions and, you know, then some help that they get. They are movable. One more group, immovable. Nobody can move them. Closed. And such people we are not talking about. Maybe God allows. We have not been born in that background. Otherwise we would have been the same. Or wheat and wheat has to grow together. Then only you will know what is wheat and what is wheat. Or sometimes you learn from them. Let me not be like them. At least I know now. I can learn something. So immovable people are there. These seminars and retreats are not for immovable people. For normally movable. So at least let us aspire to inspire before we expire. Before we die. Let's keep on inspiring in whatever way possible. So that's what Holy Father said, perfecte caritatis and lumen gentium, reminding, 50th year, the challenges and the signs of the times. Read and change your ministries and your lifestyle. So he is giving the three aims for the year of consecration. The three aims. I'm putting in the nutshell. What is my aim to declare this year? The first aim, to look to the past with gratitude. Go once again, as Perfecte Caritatis said, you go back once again to the origin. Who founded your congregation? Again and again, we remember those holy people. Who founded? We know by name at least. When did they found your congregation? What was the context? That means why? Why did they form it? What was the context? What was their response to the context? That means charism. What was the charism? How do you interpret this charism today's in the light of changing times? Charism will be outdated if you don't interpret it in the light of the changing times. They heard the cry, they responded. Today, who are the people who are calling for our response? So look to the past. And we are grateful to our founders since they responded with all the struggles. So many struggles. If you go through your founder's history, beginning history, happily went through all the struggles. And that's why today we are able to contribute to something for our society. So we are very grateful to our founders. And Holy Father says, in a nutshell, repeating Lumen Gentium number 12, all our congregations are here to a history rich in charisms, so many charisms founded at different times. During this year, Holy Father is telling us the aim. It would be appropriate for each congregation to to reflect on its origins. At least 1 month recollection during this year. Origins and history. In order to thank God who grants the church a variety of gifts through various institutes. Not one charism or one gift. Variety of gifts. So there is no comparison. There is no competition. Each charism is decorating the church. It's like a different flowers in the garden. So we need all the congregation. No, my congregation is better than the other. At that particular moment, that charism responded. That's all. Today, keep the charism. Don't change your charism. But interpret it only. How to make it? So this is the first aim. Look to the past with the gratitude. It's always good to know the history. In our families, you know, parents sometimes, they tell us the history of our family. My child, we were not like this before. When you were born, we were like this. And afterwards, we worked very hard. Today, what we are, in the same way our congregation, beginning, they never had comforts. They never had all great buildings. Worked very hard, inch by inch. Today we are very comfortable because of their hard labor. Therefore, we are grateful. We are grateful. And if you read Deuteronomy chapter 4 verse 9, Deuteronomy, afterwards you can read chapter 4 verse 9, here the Lord says, tell your children, children to children. Otherwise the children will not know the beginning. If they don't know the beginning, they will not be grateful. So tell your children to children what the Lord has done in your life. How the Lord, when you were in Egypt, how you were persecuted. We were not like this before. We had no address. We had no home. We were no people. Today we are people. We have address, everything. Yahweh did this. Then people will be very grateful. So, therefore, look to the past with gratitude. That's number 8. So, we all can do that this year at least one moment. And expressing our gratitude to our past, not only to the founder and the beginning of those who joined and then our ancestors, all those who built our congregations amidst sweat and struggle. Second aim. This year also calls us to live the present with passion. The passion, the beautiful word. Not lethargic life. Not mediocre. Not tepidity. Not doing the minimum. Striving for excellence. Doing the maximum. Full. Because you are neither cold nor warm. You know, book of Revelation we read, chapter 3, 15 and 16. You are neither cold nor warm. The zeal, the enthusiasm, that's what we are talking about. We are talking about. He speaks about passion. For the various founders and foundresses, the gospel was the absolute rule. He brings the gospel here. Whereas, every other rule was meant merely to be an expression of the gospel. Gospel was the rule. How much gospel do we know? That's the question. I'm putting the words of Holy Father. I can't change it. The question we have to ask ourselves during this year, what question? Is if and how we too are open being challenged by the gospel. They were challenged. How are we open? Whether the gospel is truly the manual for our daily living. Now families, every day people started reading the Bible, reflecting the Bible. Daily living and decisions we are called to make. The gospel is demanding. It demands us to live radically and sincerely, without justifying. It is not enough to read it, even though the reading and study of scripture is essential. Nor is it enough to meditate on it, which we do joyfully each day. He knows that we are all reading. But Jesus asks us to practice it and put his words into effect in our life. James also, be doers. Put into practice. If you read John's Gospel 13:17, John 13, verse 17. Now you know these things. Blessed are you if you practice it. Very clear. Now you know. You know the Bible. But blessed are you when? Only when you practice it. When you do it. So therefore, Holy Father is, so keep the Bible and live your life with passion. Passion. I'm asking my own question here. As we look at our present religious life, we ask, is the fire burning in our consecrated members, lit by our founders? Or has it gone out from most religions? Do we live with fusion and vision and passion for mission? Fusion. No? Solidarity with. Together with vision. When we are together with the people, we get a clear vision. And that vision should lead us to work with passion. And that is mission. If there is no fire and no passion for mission, is it a life worth living? Is just one a way of living just simply? Or is there something? We need some sense of security. Yes, definitely we need money, security. But has religious life become a fully insured and comfortable life? This is our great apostolic need today. What is the need? Not better planning, better equipments, better surveys, better conversation techniques, but better men and women whose lives are evidently charged with the power and presence of the Holy Spirit. The small group, 11 in Thailand, charged with the power and presence of the Holy Spirit. Not just a number, not just a group living with a different dress or different way of knowing. The people see us, charged. So, is the fire burning? What are we talking in our recreation? What are we talking in our refectory? What are we talking in our meeting? Sometimes we talk about the poor only in the chapter of the chapels, afterwards, no. We talk about the poor in the chapter and also in the chapel. It's the fire one. That's the second aim of Holy Father. Once again, he wants the consecrated people all over the world burning with zeal and passion. Life. Our founder and foundresses shared on Jesus' own compassion. Holy Father's words. Like Jesus, who compassionately spoke his gracious word, healed the sick, gave bread to the hungry, and offered his own life in sacrifice. Every word he means, Holy Father. So our founders and foundresses sought in different ways to be at the service of all those to whom the Spirit is sent. They did so by the prayer life, the preaching of the gospel, their works of catechesis, education, their service to the poor and the sick, the fire that was burning. Luke 12:49. I have brought fire to the earth, and I wish to see the fire burn. If that fire is not burning in us, how can we expect from others? I have brought fire to the earth. And even 3:16, Luke Gospel, he says, you need one more baptism. Not baptism of water, baptism of spirit and of fire. And John 2:17, Jesus says, I'm consumed with them. That's what I'm burning with them. The kingdom of God. Kingdom of God. So this once again, Holy Father wants us to discuss and to see that in our life. The third aim. Past with the gratitude, present with the burning zeal and passion, the future with hope. With hope. Our presence is a presence of hope. People who are losing hope in life, our message, our service, our very presence brings hope to the people. You can live without food for a month. You can live without water also for a few days. You can live even without oxygen, even a few seconds. But you cannot live even one moment without hope. When you lose hope in life, that's the moment people commit suicide. Giving hope is our ministry. This is what prayer centers are doing. This is what hospitals are doing. Doctors will never say directly, immediately, you have got cancer, fourth stage. They will never say. You will be okay. You will be all right. This is not very serious. That word itself heals some people. Giving hope. Things will change. Things will not be the same. Things will change. As Martin Luther King Jr. said in America, standing at the portals of Lincoln, Abraham Lincoln Memorial Hall, he said, we shall overcome. 1963. If not today, tomorrow. If not tomorrow, day after tomorrow. If not day after tomorrow, one day we shall overcome. Things will change. Our life is not a life of disappointments. Because who holds our future? It's God. The future is not in our hands. And Romans 4:18, because sometimes gospel makes things very clear. Romans 4:18. Hope in a hopeless situation. Even when there is no hope, religious presence will give them hope. Don't worry. Things will not go on like this. Our one word will save people. Going to the people, telling this good message, good news. There are so many people. In the prison where I'm working, this is our main task. People are simply depressed. People have lost hope. Because nobody comes to see them. Even parents don't come to see them. That's why this Holy Father, Pope Francis, every time going to the prison. He said once, you know why I'm coming to the prison? Because you can't come out. Very simple. You can't come out, therefore I'm coming. Going to the places where people are losing hope. Our main ministry today, whatever ministry we are doing, through every ministry, we give hope. This hope is, Holy Father's words, this hope is not based on statistics or accomplishments, but on the one in whom we have put our trust. The one for whom nothing is impossible. Things will change. when you read the first book of Samuel, chapter 7, then you get time to read what a wonderful sentence. Instead of remembering our birthdays and all that, remember these locations. 1 Samuel 7:12 says, up to this day the Lord led us. Won't He lead us from tomorrow? What we are today, the Lord led us. Till yesterday, if He could lead us, from today also, it's not because of our talents and goodness and our achievements and our education, qualification, we are like this. Pure God's grace. This is our hope. Holy Father's words. We all know the difficulties which the various forms of consecrated life are currently experiencing. Holy Father is aware of the realities. Decreasing vocations and aging members. Economic problems stemming from the global financial crisis. Issues of violence. These are all Holy Father's message you will get. And globalization, the threats posed by relativism and sense of isolation and social irrelevance. Plenty of issues, Holy Father is speaking. But it is precisely amidst these uncertainties that we are called to practice the virtue of hope. Not everything is fine, therefore we are very hopeful. There is no sign of hope. When Isaac was, Abraham was called to kill Isaac, offer him, last moment also, there was no hope. Very last moment, things will change. The Lord will make all things beautiful in His time, not in my time, not in my way, but in His way. Things, He will make all things beautiful. The Lord of history continues to tell us, Jeremiah 1:8, be not afraid, for I am with you. That's what Holy Father is doing today, traveling at this age of 78. Traveling. Now he is in Latin America. And he went to Israel and Palestine. What ISIS is doing to Christians, beheading them. Terrible they are. He is raising his voice without fear. Don't kill them. His issues are public issues. As we know, the church is also being rocked by scandals. Holy Father is not sitting down and crying because always scandals in the church. There will be always scandals. And 2,000 years, the church withstood the scandals and temptations because the church is Church of Jesus. If it is a human instrument, by now it would have been destroyed. Scandals will be there. Scandals will always be there. We need scandals. Even in our religious congregations, we say, how to leave them? They are scandal. Scandals will be there. But this is necessary for our energy to come out. They are not our energy. If all are okay, down silence. There must be somebody keep on giving problem, then your energy will come out. Then you will think what to do next. What else you will do? You will sleep. That's all. Nothing to see. Be grateful to the people who are giving you trouble. They are keeping you alive. So, Holy Father takes that way. Scandals. He is doing what he can do. He is doing it. Responding to the scandal. He is not talking only about the scandal all the time. He is going out of that. So many issues are affecting people. Are we worried about all this? These are the three aims. So next he speaks of five expectations. This is our theme. Three aims to declare this year. Then, what are my expectations? Holy Father says, my five expectations during this year. First expectation. Where there are religious, there is joy. I don't know why this Holy Father all that time talking about joy. Vatican, he doesn't experience a joy among cardinals and bishops. More serious. No, we never heard any other holy father speaking about the joy. One encyclical Evangelii Gaudium already. Rejoice already. All the time talks about be joyful, joyful. One message is very clear with our Holy Father. Joy. None of us should be discontented and dissatisfied. A gloomy disciple is a disciple of doom. Already destruction has come. Like everyone else, we have our troubles. Holy Father also knows we have some people giving trouble. Everybody has got troubles. Our dark nights of the soul, our disappointments and infirmities, sicknesses. But in all these things, we should be able to discover perfect joy, again and again joy. For it is here that we learn to recognize the face of Christ, who became like us in all things, and to rejoice in the knowledge that we are being conformed to Him, who out of love for us did not refuse the sufferings of the cross. Cross is part of this consecrated day. We should never forget. Sufferings, part of our life. Sufferings will not come in the wooden cross. Sufferings will come to anybody. Some sufferings because of our own weaknesses. There are two kinds of sufferings. Some sufferings because of our own weaknesses and selfishness. The other kind of suffering, result of our mission. The mission brings the suffering. Our loneliness, our being far away from our dear and near ones, our being not understood by the people when they are working with the different kinds of people. These are our mission sufferings. So, when I am weak, then I am strong. Rejoice in our weaknesses. Rejoice. I am weak. None of us are perfect. Philippians chapter 1, 6 says, one day the Lord brings us to completion. One day. Until then, we all have our own imperfections. So I don't feel guilty about it. God understands. And I don't boast about anything else, only my weaknesses. So He expects religious to be joyful. Hope of joy. He not only says, every time he can see the joy. Pope Francis gets a thumbs up on that. As he is able to show his joy so plainly, as if he has no problem in Vatican. In the whole universal church, we are not able to carry on 100 members or 200 members. Heavy burden. But Holy Father is carrying millions of people. Joy. According to Pope Francis, the biggest danger and temptations in life are discouragement, discord and the devil. A Christian without joy is either not a Christian or he is sick. Very punching words. Every word, don't know where he gets his words. Very punching. Long faces cannot proclaim Jesus. Because ours is good news. How can you proclaim good news with the long faces? He's not like simply laughing and joking and shouting. There's inner joy. That's why sometimes he says, I don't want a flight attendant to smile. In the flight, when you get in, they all smile, not because they love us. That is their duty, to smile. Not that kind of smile. You know, when he went to cloister convent in Assisi, you know that. You must have read everywhere. So he saw the nuns fixed smiles. Fixed smile also is there. Half part-time smile. Once a week, he smiles. So I am so disappointed when I meet nuns who are, you know, cloistered there, Assisi, who are joyless, who may smile with the smile of a flight attendant, but not with the smile of joy that comes from within. The pontiff told nuns at Santa Clara Cloister. nuns must endeavor to be experts in humanity in order that convent life is not purgatory. Thank God he didn't say convent life is hell. There is still hope, purgatory. We can get out. Know how to forgive, how to tolerate each other, because the devil takes every opportunity to demise. There was one priest in a community of religious priest. He couldn't see the sight of the provincial. He was in the provincial community. So every time when he sees the provincial, he gets agitated. So then he decided, one day he thought, what can I do with this man? He bought a parrot. You know what is parrot? Yeah. Trained the parrot to repeat something. Let the provincial die. So let the provincial die. And trained the parrot and kept it in the middle of the house where the provincial will be passing very often. From the room to the chapel or to outside. And whenever the parrot sees the provincial, the loudly says, let the provincial die. The provincial felt so bad about that. You know, it pained him. Thinking what? But then he went to the general later. He met the general, superior general. Father, there is one priest in my provincial community. All the time he hates me. Therefore he trained one parrot and the parrot looks at me and says, let the provincial die. Then the general was very good. Don't worry, I have another parrot which is very spiritual, very prayerful also. You take this parrot. I have trained this parrot spiritually. You take the parrot and keep it at the side of the parrot of the priest. Provincial was very happy. He returned from Rome with the parrot and kept it near his priest parrot. The next day, provincial was passing. Once again, the priest parrot let the provincial die. And the superior general parrot, very prayerful, Lord, hear our prayer. John's Gospel, if you read 105 times, the word world comes. Every time John speaks about, I'm not of this world, you are of this world. I want my people not to take away from the world. I have not come to condemn the world. Something like that, repeatedly. In all the other books, if you find the word world, it comes to 75 times. But only John's Gospel 105 times. What is this world? This world was very good when God created and God said good. Now, what is this world that we are part of? A world now which has become violent. A world full of selfishness. A world committing, you know, killing people, murdering people, treating others like animals. And indifference, globalized indifference. This is the world. You religious, go and wake up. You wake up first to the reality of your beautiful vocation. You enjoy your vocation and then that joy will give you energy to go and wake up others. Yeah, joyless means energyless. Our energy comes from our happiness. So you can be different. I am expecting from you, he says, it's the witness that I expect from you. Don't be like just like everybody. Be different in your way of living and talking. And so the third, you are called to be experts in communion that we discussed so much yesterday. Third expectation, communion. Just a few words of Holy Father, what he says about it. He says, I ask you, he says, about my frequent comments about, comments. What are the comments of Holy Father? About criticism, gossip, envy, jealousy, hostility as ways of acting which have no place in our communities. And in the last two and a half years, Holy Father must have spoken about gossip so many times. Don't gossip. When you gossip, you are murdering the person. You are doing the work of Judas. Maybe Holy Father, many are gossiping about you. Especially Vatican. Therefore, he knows what is happening around. So don't gossip, gossip and irritate. So this kills our communion in our communities. So Holy Father speaks about communion. So that, we have no time, so this is a short one. The fourth one, what is he expecting? My expectation. First one, be joyful. Second one, you wake up and then wake up the world. And the third one, be experts in communion, avoiding this kind of gossips and jealousy and all that. Fourth one, go into all the world. This is very important for Holy Father. That he is doing also. He is not sitting in Vatican and telling us and writing encyclicals from there. He is doing what is, in this age, all the way he came to Philippines only to meet the people affected by typhoon. Who will do this today? You know, when people are affected, he's going. And then he met the street children, he spoke to them, and come out of yourselves and go forth to the existential peripheries. The whole world awaits us. Men and women who have lost all hope, they are waiting for us. Families in difficulty, abandoned children, young people without a future, the elderly, sick and abandoned, those who are rich in the world's goods but impoverished within. Men and women looking for a purpose in life, thirsting for the divine. That's what I said in the beginning itself. One of the signs, spirituality. So many people are waiting for religious. And also he speaks about prisoners many times. Don't be closed in on yourself. Don't be stifled by petty squabbles. Don't remain a hostage to your own problem. Whenever we meet together, what are we talking about? About whom we talk about? Our own problem. Our own injustices. These will be resolved. Your problems will be resolved if you go forth and help others to resolve their own problems and proclaim the good. You will find life by giving life, hope by giving hope, love by giving love. Take something like St. Francis Assisi prayer. Let me love before I ask others to love me. Let me console others. Let me forgive. Let me do first. Rather than expecting me to get all these things. So, it's to go into the world so that your problems will be nothing. You know, whenever you know that, those who are working like this with the suffering people, get in the field. Pope Francis hates any member of the clergy, religious, who sit in offices and push papers. Today, most of us are doing paperwork. Paper. When one chapter comes, how many paperworks? So much of paper. By the time we finish paperwork, another chapter. Junior ministers will send questions. And as provincial will send another questionnaire. By the time general will send another questionnaire. By the time conference of religious will send one questionnaire. By the time bishops will send. Our life goes only in paperwork. So paper becomes important than people. People are disturbances for us. Therefore, paper. As a bishop in Buenos Aires, where he was there that time, would dress as a plain priest, as a bishop, go out at night to talk with the people. When he became Pope, he told one of his archbishops, I can't do that anymore. You can't just get out now from Vatican. So you are going to do it for me. He's telling all the bishops to get out. Then what about us? He doesn't want, you can also tell your archbishop to get out. Because Holy Father says, he doesn't want a pristine, clean church. He wants a church that's going out in the streets to find the people and help. Repeatedly says, I want a church which dirties itself by going to the people. That is his fourth expectation. The last. I expect that, very beautiful last one. Each congregation, we did it already yesterday evening without knowing, will question what it is that God and people today are asking of them. It's our duty. Not that we plan and do whatever we want. Sometimes we need to invite our lay people, our staff members for our general chapters. Let them tell us what they expect from us instead of we decide for them. They have the right to tell us. Now, totally slowly changing, we are inviting others. In the bishops' conferences, they are inviting the women and lay people. Let them also tell us what they expect from bishops. So this is asking us to do this year at least. This year at least, ask for a feedback and evaluation. All our ministries, this first thing, all our ministries, our works and our presence consonant with what the Spirit asked of our founders? Is it this? It's connected to? Are they suitable for carrying out today? Are they relevant today? In society and the church, those same ministries and works started 100 years ago, 200 years ago. Do we have the same passion for our people? Are we close to them to the point of sharing in their joys and sorrows? Thus truly understanding their needs and helping to respond to them, very soul-searching questions. Not simply one every 6 years, one chapter, let's go and then whatever we have planned, we will do it. No. Ask the people. It's better to ask even our young novices, what do they expect from religious? They will be in a better position to tell us. Ask even our children, students, teachers, the parishioners, because these are the people for whom we are working. Therefore, they should tell us what they expect from us. That will transform our life. So, he's concluding. I entrust this year of consecrated life to Mary, the last point of Lumen Gentium, Mother Mary. So, he's entrusting all of us to Mother Mary, the Virgin of listening and contemplation. The first disciple of her beloved son. Let us look to her, the highly beloved daughter of the Father, endowed with every gift of grace, as the unsurpassed model for all those who follow Christ in love of God and service to their neighbor. Very beautiful intervention. I accompany you, the Holy Father is in Rome, let's take these words. I accompany all of you with my apostolic blessing. From the Vatican, 21st November 14th, Feast of the Presentation of the Blessed Virgin Mary. My concluding the last, I conclude, though religious life, as it is lived today, is in profound transition, we know it. We cannot doubt its relevance in the postmodern world. I have a feeling, definitely religious life will flourish. May not be in this form, but a different form, which is not very new to history. It will flourish. We still know our identity and believe in consecrated life. It is the responsibility of each individual consecrated person to make the needed shift in your life in order to be on fire and together. Thank you very much.
Sr.Inigo, brothers in Chai Fonseca, allow me to share a few things with you. These things may look fragmented or disintegrated. At the end, hope you can synthesize for me. I just shared with my friend, my partner, Sister Bettina. We have been knowing for the past 30 years now, old friends meet. So I would like to repeat what I have shared with her. First of all, personally, I express my gratitude for your sharing, for your presentation. You helped me personally to confirm and affirm my commitment, though I am not able to attend fully this session. I feel that Pope Francis has high esteem in John Paul II. I can see something like the line of convergence from what John Paul had told us long time ago, and many things may be forgotten on the way. I encourage myself first that as an administrator or as a good leader, many times we are one-sided heavy, not living fully integrated life as prescribed by the Constitution. We are urged that we have to live integration or equilibrium prior to work. But as time passed by as a professional, we put more emphasis on secular life or professionalism. We have read a lot on technology, administration, any update issue of the world. But we lack time and space to focus ourselves, to read more on many important issues, church documents or ecclesial documents. I remind me, we should go back and spend some time as prescribed by our constitutions, we put as a part of spiritual reading. Why not we recall Vita Consecrata? Why not we recall starting afresh from Christ? Why not we recall consecrated persons and mission in the school for those who are involved in mission in the school? These things, apart from any other many more exhortations or encyclicals from John Paul, I can see many things similarly that the present Paul tried to bring back, bring home those words. You confirmed this morning about expert of communion. John Paul and Francis put more emphasis on contemplation and mission, because the fruit of our mission is the fruit of contemplation. John Paul asks us, yes, we are privileged, we can be happy to recall our history, but we still have history to be accomplished in the future. We have started number 110, something like that. And the same thing that Francis encourages to do the same, that we still have future. So my point is that why not we make ourselves integrated, keep a new balance. Going on, okay, keep on reading those secular subjects as a good professional. But why not give more time to read these ecclesial documents to make us balance, to keep a new balance? And I think that these things will be digested. And as time passes by in the future, when we give at prayers, when we give conference, now not only secular operational part of you, but there will be something more on spiritual, something more of, I don't know, eschatological or something like that. We need the real message to transmit the message of John Paul and Francis. This is personal conversion. This is personal quest, this is personal research. And I can say that nobody can do us to make, to give us that integration of life. And I can say that people will see us change, that now we are not professional, but we are spiritual leader. That's I would like to share with you.
Very good, sir. Very good. Very much, sir. What you are saying is very true, because we have gone far ahead in our professional. You know, when we are working in the school, that professionalism we need, because we have to do that work fully. But we are religious. As you are saying, what is prepared in 1965, now only we are reading Lumen Gentium. So many years over. Veda Consecrata already 1994, where I was at Senate. Now so many years are over. How many of us know nothing? Documents come there, but every document is so rich. When we start reading, reflecting, we will have less time for gossips. No? Less time for community problems. So then we will be enriched also, our thinking level. It will be different also. So maybe it's high time that we all need to, I was telling the other day also, we don't have reading, especially the encyclicals for us too high for us to understand immediately. Think. Some experts are there. We can call them, if you are interested, you can call them and learn, so that our level of spirituality, level of understanding will go little higher. Not that all the time we look at somebody, what they want to. It's already there in the booklets. It's already there. Beautiful booklets are coming, documents are coming, encyclicals are coming. We are fortunate that way. In no other religion, they get such encyclicals for the religious leaders. I always think, for Hindus, there is nobody to remind them for fasting. For us from Rome, from diocese, we get all reminders that Good Friday fasting. But Hindus fast without these reminders. For them, they don't need reminders, because they feel it's my God and my religion. So therefore, as you say, all these documents of reading and reflecting and internalizing, and sharing also when we gather together, rather than about third person, fourth person. It's good for us. Thank you very much for this integration that you are talking about. One side, professional. The other side, we are not just professionals, we are also religious. Yes, sister.
I do agree with brother, but I would like to share just only at some point, maybe the other side of the coin. As far as we have problems in Thailand, because our country is a Buddhist context. Many conference, many international conference, they would like to hear about the Catholic Church, teaching of our Catholic Church. And we seek a lot to find out the one who can share in the Vatican multicultural context. As brother said, we would like to go back to read, to study, to interpret. But we need also the one who share, to the one who would like to know, to learn. Once I joined a conference on dying patients, they would like to know what the nurses are going to do with the dying patient, particularly the last moment of life. I shared to them, but some issues are related to being a priest. The duty and the responsibility of the priest, that's the question in Thailand, and how can we solve this problem? I just let this, not the problem, issue to the conference.
think this is something different. Just, I think, we as religious, in many times we were trained to focus only my community and my province, my work and my responsibility, and to communicate across even the same congregation, but not think about other congregations, but to even communicate and collaborate with other units within the same congregation. Right now, we are facing this kind of challenge, and we call in the term of provincialism. So it's focused so much on its own province, not like many leaders cannot see beyond their own province, only the needs of the province, which is somewhat like the saying that we focus so much on ourselves. I think this type of a conference would help us to be like a wake-up call, I think, to remind ourselves that the needs of others sometimes are important. I think if we tend to the need of others, there will be also a healing for us as well.
So that's in India, the conference of religious.
Yes. So we are 12 members of different congregations, including me. We are working in the prison. It's a huge prison. One congregation cannot work. So therefore, 12 of us, all 12 from different congregations. So we come together once a month and we share. At the same time, we are not losing our personal charism, but for the common good, all congregations follow the gospel. So that is one thing. In Singapore, Malaysia, recently when the conference came together, different congregations, they said, we will give members, we will work for what is the main issue in Singapore, Malaysia, trafficking or migrant problems. So one congregation cannot work. These are big common issues of the country. Because we belong to a country, country's common issues are congregation issues. We shouldn't all that and think about our community problem, our school issues, no. So therefore, what is the common issue in Thailand so that we can make our presence felt in this country as religious? A conference of religious, men and women together. What is your common issue which calls for religious presence? So this is also a very good idea that you could think of when you come together.
Thank you. Any more question? More addition? It seems that maybe Father Shai has something to say. May I invite Father Shai to say something to Sr.Inigo. ขอบคุณพ่อชายจะเป็นตัวแทนของพวกเราขอบคุณซิสเตอร์อินิโก้นะคะ
I would not exhaust that. So after a big bang or explosion of praise during this two full loaded days and a half of explosion of praise and explosion of love. You know, we'd like to thank God for sending Sr.Inigo here, you know, very, very well, warmly received, and your deliberation is fantastic. And also we thank the organizers, you know, who were organizers, so we thank you also. And Sister, the provincial lovers of the cross of Canterbury, what's your name? Okay, she reminded me that please don't forget to thank Sister Sonji, our simultaneous translator. So thank you, Sister. You're the simultaneous translator second to me. Okay. Very, very good. Stop joking. Okay. And after attending your session, Sister, I would, at this very moment, ask the audience, what do you think? What do you think? After her exposition and so on and so forth, what do you think? Everybody, come up. I will verbalize your action, you know, fantastic, excellent, superb, very, very good. Okay, all those words. And after listening to you, you know, we are more convinced that we know that you are the most sought after speaker as a resource person in the world, I think. Not only that, Sister, but during these 2 days, you are the great pearl, you are the pearl of great price for us. Wonderful. A gem, a real gem. So thank you very much. And in your exposition and in your deliberation and exploration, you unpacked it for us many, many issues about the consecrated life. Many, many issues. And some of your comments kind of shook us and shocked us to the core, and for which we are very, very grateful. Okay, brother, you agree with me? Okay.